Welcome back to the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games here in Madison, Wisconsin, as we set the stage for event number 6 in men's competition with heat 1 of the Triple G Chipper. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, and Sam Farber with you here in Madison, Wisconsin, as we get ready for this next test where we're going to throw a mixed bag of 5 different movements. Here in this one, 100 pull-ups, 80 GHD sit-ups, 60 one-legged squats. They will alternate each foot as they move through. 40 calories on the rower, 20 dumbbell push presses with the ultra-heavy 100-pound dumbbell to close it out in this 14-minute time cap event.
And I love this event when they come into event number 6 because it requires so much strategy.
It's just like most athletes have a dominant arm. A lot of them have a dominant leg too, and the judges here have thought of that. If you attempt a pistol and get no rep or fail, you have to take the next rep on the same leg. So if you're right foot dominant and you fail on the left foot, you don't get a breather and go back to your dominant side. You've got to repeat the process with your weaker leg. That could cost some athletes who try and go too fast an awful lot of time.
Our first wave of athletes here in heat number 1, a couple of names that you would not expect to see in the bottom half of the point standings after 5 events. That includes in lane number 8, Cole Sager. Bit of a surprise there. Elijah Muhammad in lane number 12, Alex Smith in lane 15, but most notably near the back of the pack in lane 18, Josh Bridges.
And I'm waiting for him to buck the trend. I know I kind of bring his name up every time, but this is an event for Josh Bridges. I said that last night during Amanda 45, but this is an event that he can do well here for this long chipper.
Josh Bridges, the updated graphic, the updated standings, I should say, 36th place coming into this event. Cole Sager, another athlete that is very surprising to see in the back half.
Well, he's always been a slow starter at the games, and now I'm kind of, okay, it's time. It's event 6. Let's get back into the groove. Let's do what you do best, and that's make comebacks. He's the comeback kid for a reason. It's end of day or nearing end of day 2. He's running out of events to make some ground up.
Somebody in 30th place that can definitely make a move in this event with all the gymnastics elements would be the younger brother of Ben Smith, Alex Smith, here in this heat.
Well, he's definitely one of those bodyweight freaks because of how good he is at gymnastics. And when you start with 100 pull-ups, GHD sit-ups, pistols in row, those movements are good for him. I don't know about the volume of movements being good for him. I'll see how he handles the dumbbell after all of that work.
First time in the Coliseum setting, we're seeing a heat of 20 athletes all moving at the same time. And you're gonna see a lot of butterfly pull-ups going on at once as they open up with 100 pull-ups to start the chipper.
Now, what I don't want to see is a lot of pull-ups unbroken to start this event. This isn't like the wall ball pull-up event we saw at regionals a year ago where it started with 104 wall ball shots into those unbroken pull-ups at like 52. But it's a long workout. It's a lot of reps. I know it's only a 14-minute cap, so length relative to what they've done so far isn't that much. But you don't need to do big sets. What's the point of doing 50 and 50? Right, when you have so much work left to go. That being said, if you're very good at pull-ups, there's nothing wrong with big sets. Because what do they have next? The GHD, which requires zero upper body arm pulling. And in fact, they're not going to use their arms again until they get to the rower after the pistol. So they can afford to go bigger. They just don't need to go into that red line off the start.
There's an alternate strategy, and it's just going for it. If you're in danger in the points positioning, Zach Carchetti broke off a chain of 67 unbroken to start this round of 100 pull-ups. He was the leader briefly. Now it's Jeff Patzer. You'll notice his name highlighted in blue at the top of the screen with the rep number 74. That's where he is as the leader. Everybody else's number will be showing how many reps they are behind the lead.
And if you're good at pull-ups, be good at pull-ups. Just don't overstretch your bounds. But as you said, you know, you get to a certain point on the leaderboard at a certain time in the weekend, then hey, I'm at the CrossFit Games. There's no, you know, you don't know if you're gonna make it back. You wanna make the most of what you can with the opportunities that you have. So going big early, deep in these sets, it's not a terrible idea if you're sitting low on the leaderboard.
1:53.2 for Jeff Patzer to make his way from the pull-up bar to the GHD apparatus. Well, they'll have 80 sit-ups.
And this is where you want to kind of settle into your pace. It's 80 total. We saw 100 2 years ago at the regional level. A man who dismantled that workout is Josh Bridges, who just got to the GHD. So what I'd like to see is give me my Josh back, please. I want to see this guy. He has one of the top three most wins of any individual all time at the CrossFit Games because of events like this. I'd want to see Josh back to get back to true form.
Coming off of the pull-up bar, Jeff Patzer in first, Josh Bridges second, Alex Smith third, Paul Castillo and Zeke Grove were neck and neck for fifth, coming away from the pull-up bar onto the second movement of five, the GHD, where they're working to rep number 180 before they advance to the one-legged squats.
And you can have a lot of different strategies on the 80 GHD sit-ups. You can break them up into quick sets of 10, maybe take some rest, 20s. 50, 30, I mean, I can throw any rep scheme you want out there, but you want to do is work within your means. 80 GHD sit-ups is a lot of reps. Patzer, I like that break. Here's what the GHD is doing, is that we have what movement after this? A pistol, a single leg squat where one leg has to be sticking out in almost an L-sit position the entire time. What does the GHD tax only? Hip flexors, psoas, the core muscles that allow you to hold your leg out straight in front. So putting 60 pistols after this is a very, I would say, dirty trick by Dave Castro.
It's almost like he's slightly evil sometimes.
No, he's evil.
Most of the time.
Not slightly. He's like slightly nice sometimes.
Approaching rep number 50 of 80 for Josh Bridges, who has now found himself in the lead, and that's a usual position for him in terms of his historical trends at the CrossFit Games, but this year, it's the first time we've seen him contending for a heat win, really all weekend.
It's a beautiful pace by Josh Bridges, and it's consistent, and he did the same thing in the California Regional in 2015. Now, what Patzer's doing is another good strategy. Don't just rest sitting at the top. That's still going to tax your hip flexors and your psoas, and that's just the muscles that open and close the hip, which is what you're going to need here in a little bit when you get to the pistols, especially when you get to the dumbbells. I don't think these guys really know what's waiting for them at the end. 20 dumbbells shouldered overheads with a 100-pound dumbbell looks very innocent on paper. After everything that they're going to go through before they get there, it's going to be a rude awakening once they get that to their shoulders and overhead for the first time.
Judge's hand up in the air indicating the final five reps on the GHD sit-ups for Josh Bridges, the former Navy SEAL. Will be the first athlete to move from the GHD apparatus and into the set of 60 one-legged squats, where he will advance every 20 reps.
You see him shaking out his legs because not only does it tax the hip flexors, but the quads as well. You need to fire those legs to bring yourself up. So these pistols, you got to make sure you sit more on the heel. If you do that, that's going to require more hamstrings and glutes to help get yourself up. If you have guys that have bad positioning, they're going to pitch forward more on their toes, and that's going to blow up their quads even more.
10 reps down, 50 reps remain. If you want to correct myself, they'll advance every 10 reps on the one-legged squats. And he has opened up a wide lead over Jeff Patzer. 15 reps the difference, 42 seconds in terms of the time coming off of the GHD sit-ups. But Bridges with multiple no reps at this point.
And I was just going to touch on that. I don't think those were no reps at all. Here's the problem with that judge. He's sitting on the right side of Josh Bridges, and he's no repping his left leg. There is no vantage point for that judge to judge Josh Bridges on the left side. If he's going to look, see that same thing. That was a good rep. That was a good rep for Bridges. He's getting plenty low. I know the left side might be a little bit harder for him, but he needs to get a bit more vantage point to take away a rep from that side.
See a no rep as well for Patzer on the left side of the screen. A couple of other athletes trying to move into the picture. Jason Carroll is in third, 17 reps behind Bridges. Travis Williams over in lane number two in the bright yellow shorts on the left side of the screen in fourth.
And it's not a surprise to see Williams up there. I think most people peg him as just a strong athlete. This guy is a grunt. He will work through reps with no self-preservation whatsoever. What's the perfect workout for a guy like that? A long chipper.
A Working towards rep number 240 in the one-legged squat portion of this five-part chipper. That's 10 reps away for Josh Bridges. As you see him in the section of the floor, that shows number 60 as we work towards a 15-minute time cap. We're about halfway there at the 7.5-minute mark.
Now, what this row needs to be is two things, and it's going to sound silly to say, is that it needs to be somewhat of recovery, but not ground loss. You will not win this workout on the rower, but you can lose too much ground because you don't have a lot of reps left. Those 20 reps, however, are very, very heavy reps. I'm talking about a 100-pound dumbbell. So for someone like Josh Bridges, you need to recover a little bit more. Look how much work you did. You did well on the pull-ups, you crushed the GHDs, and you were very smooth and methodical on the pistols. You don't need to make up time on an implement that you're probably not as good at as, say, some of the bigger, stronger athletes. What you need to do is conserve energy and try to make that dumbbell a little bit easier if you can.
Second athlete onto the rower you see on the far left side of the screen, Jason Carroll. This is Paul Castillo, who's joining the fray as well as Travis Williams and Jeff Patzer, our early leader here in Heat 1.
And I'm trying to look at these names up there in the top five as they navigate through this. You have Bridges, who's just a chipper master. Anything that has lots of reps, he excels in. Carroll, he's a grunt work, nose down type of worker. Patzer, he's got the skill set with the gymnastics movements. We'll see what happens on the rower. We'll definitely see what happens with that dumbbell. I don't think it's going to go well, personally. And then you have Travis Williams and Castillo. All these guys are grindstone, anvil-type guys where they can sit on there and get beat on and still keep working through the reps.
Jason Carroll, one of the most free-spirited, loosest kind of athletes you'll find out there. He was known for dancing a lot during the 2016 and 2017 California Regionals. You can see him playing with the camera for a little bit there as he finishes up the row.
I think Jason Carroll thought it stopped at 30 cals, and the judge had to told him he got 10 more, big guy.
But he has closed the gap on Josh Bridges, only 2 calories back.
And that's totally fine for Josh. Like I said before, you didn't need to blow yourself out. In fact, maybe recover a little bit. You put in so much work, you can let these guys try to catch you. That's one way to mess with the heat that you're in. Go out fast enough that you throw other people off their game.
Josh Bridges, 5'5", 173 pounds, one of the lightest athletes in the field. That is a 100-pound dumbbell that he is throwing over his head.
The hardest part about this rep, aside from the weight, is the re-rep. Bringing that weight down with one arm is going to take a very precise position so that it doesn't slide off the side of the shoulder. You saw Josh kind of get a little bit squirrely resetting for the second repetition. So the re-rack might end up being the most important key to this movement.
Most dangerous man right now, maybe this one. Travis Williams getting to that 100-pound dumbbell. He's the largest athlete in the top three working on this final movement. They will advance that dumbbell, by the way. Every 5 reps, they'll also rotate arms every 5 reps.
Josh Bridges got a no rep in that set. And when you're talking about 20 repetitions at this weight, that hurts physically and mentally at the same time.
Williams has pulled within 4 reps of Bridges. Carroll struggling a little bit with that dumbbell on the first 5 reps. He's starting to fade. Paul Castillo is a few reps behind as well. He's moved into third. Travis Williams closing in as Bridges finishes his 10th rep. There that is, as they work towards rep number 300, then the sprint to the finish line. They advance the dumbbell simultaneously. Bridges and Williams working towards rep number 15. Quicker transition for Josh Bridges, but Travis Williams has the significant strength advantage between the two.
What Travis needs to do is to kind of keep his focus as he starts to get fatigued, but you know, if you're going to put two guys against each other at the end with a movement like this, I'm going to pick Travis Williams every time.
And Travis Williams keeping that dumbbell on his shoulders. He'll save the rep by staying in the box. That is one good one. He has 4 reps remaining on the left side of the screen. Bridges seeing that lead fade. And maybe second place as well, as Paul Castillo has caught him, moving to the 20 spot as well. But Travis Williams with 1 rep remaining. And he will get his first career event win at the CrossFit Games. Travis Williams will take the heat at 12 minutes. Paul Castillo was not far behind, 6 seconds back. Josh Bridges gets a no rep for leaving the box that he has to stay in. And Tim Paulson has come from nowhere. He's now past Josh Bridges. Paulson in lane number four, and here comes Paulson, the East Regional rookie, in third at 12:24. Josh Bridges forgot the dumbbell. He'll now make his way to the platform, and he falls from first all the way down to fourth in the final movement.
Said it gets heavy towards the end. Very heavy towards the end.
Somebody else that has fallen down the standings here is Jeff Patzer, as Cole Sager is in. George Sanchez is in. Michael Palomba has finished as well in seventh here in the heat. Jason Carroll holds on to eighth. Jeff Patzer is just now across the line in ninth. Samuel Quant rounding out our top 10 here in heat number one. James Newbury. Next finisher will be fellow Australian Zeke Grove. Travis Williams' time, it wins his first ever heat at the games at 12 minutes, 0.26 seconds. That's a solid time with one heat remaining. Zach Carchetti, he went for broke on the pull-ups, going 67 unbroken to start it. And, well, heads up to everybody that's still going to take this one on that.
Oh, went for broke, and he did.
Alex Smith in 15th, Mitchell Cinnamon, you see him stepping on the platform in 16th at 13:47. We're a minute away from our 15-minute time cap. Next finisher, lane number lane number six, should be Rob Forte. And he will make his way onto the platform. Seven-time games athlete, finishing 17th here in heat number one. And that leaves the two men that were throwing jabs at each other during the snatch event, Tommy Vinas and Elijah Muhammad.
Well, I mean, that's what I said. You're going to get different events for athletes and their skill set. Theirs is snatching, clearly. With these longer events that we saw yesterday and this one that has multiple reps, it's just not in their wheelhouse yet.
Tommy Venus nearly took out the poor judge that was standing in the way with that 100-pound dumbbell as well. And Elijah Muhammad will round out the field. He will beat the time cap by 10 seconds at 14:50.36. But our top time coming out of heat number one, Travis Williams. He always seems to make it exciting. And this time it wasn't him out in front early on, but he actually caught up in the end and made some passes to take the heat at 12:26.
I'd say that's a little bit of a newer Travis Williams here at the competition floor, is being a bit more passive in the beginning and saving a little bit towards the end.
So that's heat one. We'll have heat number two coming up next. So one heat down, one heat remains in men's event number six at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games here in Madison, Wisconsin, as it's time for the Triple G Chipper.
Or what I like to call the Fikowski event, because you have a lot of reps, a lot of strategy, and there's no one better to tackle an event like this. 100 pull-ups, 80 GC sit-ups, pistols, row, and dumbbell push presses at 100 pounds. This is a Brent Fikowski workout. This is my horse in this event.
And Brent Fikowski comes into this one 54 points behind Matt Fraser for the points lead. They are the top two, and they'll be here in this heat as Matt Fraser, the points leader in lane 10. Brent Fikowski in lane number 11. And somebody else to keep an eye on in terms of that rabbit roll may just be Cody Anderson in lane number 17. He might be baiting some people into a pace they might not want to go to.
Well, he'll be chasing Matt Fraser the entire time, because I know I said Fikowski's my horse, but the guy to upset that possible victory is the reigning fittest man in the world, Matt Fraser, because he's smart and he's just super fit. Brent Fikowski, he's just so cerebral when he's out there. When you put in hundreds, 80s, 60s numbers of repetitions, that guy's going to dismantle an event like this.
15-minute time cap starts with 100 pull-ups. You'll notice the leader's name highlighted in blue. It will show how many reps they have completed. Everybody else will be in red. And if it has a minus number in that box, it's how many reps they are behind the lead.
Hopefully these guys took a little page out of what not to do in heat number one, and that's big sets on the pull-up bar. It's not a matter of can you, but it's more a matter of should you. Doing 50 pull-ups, even if you go 50, 30, 20, that is not hard for athletes like this. Cody Anderson has been reps away from doing 100 unbroken pull-ups himself. But the only thing that's going to happen after that is nothing. You're going to be dead for the rest of the event, even though you have the GHD sit-ups coming up next.
Anderson actually dropping at rep number 44. And you mentioned the ability of Brent Fikowski in these style of events. 2013, 2014, 15, 16, 17, the only man to finish every regional chipper is Brent Fikowski. His prowess in this style of event is well known, and he's a favorite for a good reason.
You know, we had some longer events last year at the Games, but not a real chipper style event like this. So I want to see if that regional, you know, success can transfer here on the big stage in Madison.
Cody Anderson, the leader by 11 reps. He's already through 81 of 100 pull-ups. Matt Fraser sitting in third, 9 reps back.
Now what you'll see is you're probably gonna see Fikowski get off the pull-up bars as one of the last athletes. He's just a longer guy. He's one of the heavier athletes on the field. He doesn't need to blow up 100 pull-ups off the bat. That's not where he will succeed. Where he will is the GHD, the pace on the pistols. And then when Fikowski gets to the rower, that's when we'll see him take charge.
Another athlete in the top five here on the pull-up portion of this event, Jason Smith. It's been a real Cinderella story in the Games this year, sitting in sixth place.
If you're going to place $1,000 and who's going to come off the pull-up bar first, I think this would, in your odds, about 100 to 1. You would have won $1 because it's no surprise to see Cody Anderson get off the pull-up rig first.
Now, Jeff Patzer came off the pull-up bar at a minute 53.2 seconds. Anderson comes off at 204, so a little bit slower of a pace, and that actually seems really conservative for Anderson.
And it's good. That's what you want to see. He's one of the best at the Games at this particular movement. Why not make it even easier by not having to try hard and still get off the pull-up rig first?
So our leaders off the pull-up bar, they're onto the GHD apparatus for 80 GHD sit-ups. They're working towards rep number 180 on our ticker.
I like the steady pace across the board for these athletes. Matt Fraser, no stranger to high volume GHD sit-ups in the middle of chippers.
And near the back of the pack, still with 5 pull-ups remaining, and this is as you predicted, Brent Fikowski currently sitting in the 17th position.
I did say he'd get off the pull-up bar later than most guys. I'm just hoping he's not leaving too much room between him and the rest of the field. So hopefully he can make up some time on these middle 3 movements, the GHD, pistols. He'll definitely make up some ground on the row, but you don't want to sprint too hard to try to catch people. Those dumbbells get heavy at the end.
Fikowski and Frederick Agidius came off the pull-up bar at the same time to bring up the rear of the field after 1 of 5 movements here in this chipper. And for Fikowski, largest athlete in the field at 6'2", 215 pounds.
Now that range of motion isn't going to help him very much on the pistol side, but it is that tempo and strategy that he has in his back pocket that can help him navigate some of the trickier parts just physically for him.
Fikowski actually adjusting the GHD itself as he's trying to chase down Matt Fraser, not just in this event, but also in the point standings. Fraser, it's looking like he might be setting himself up for a position to run away with this one for a second consecutive year. He is just on that kind of run. Amazingly enough, going back to the start of last year, just 1 event win for Matt Fraser.
Yeah, and you know, we said you don't have to win a lot of events to win the CrossFit Games. You just need to be consistent across the board. He's always consistently, I feel like he might have the most second place finishes in Games history. That guy is just always there at the top. Now, he doesn't have the flash of wins, say, like Brent Fikowski or Josh Bridges, but I guarantee you he'll trade a lifetime of first place event finishes for another CrossFit Games first place finish.
In fact, 1 year ago, 7 second place finishes in events out of 15 events for Matt Fraser, a record by far in terms of that stat. New leader is Yona Koski as he has passed Cody Anderson on the GHD sit-ups. Koski in the black tank top near the center of the screen. There's a look at Finland's Joona Koski, now a resident of Dubai.
I like that smooth pace. He seems to be just going at consistent pace. We saw the same thing from Josh Bridges in the previous heat, where he went 80 straight, smooth at the top. You almost want to kind of sit up, take a breath at the top, lay back down.
And 5:28, Joona Koski onto the one-legged squats again. They will advance every 10 reps. They do have to alternate legs every rep. And if you get a no rep like Joona just did, then you have to repeat the rep on that leg.
So it's 60 total reps at such high volume for pistols at this point in time for the event. Having a no rep isn't necessarily costly, but it's just unnecessary extra work that you don't want to do.
Top four through the GHD sit-ups. Joona Koski in the black tank top. Street Horner in the purple shorts on the right side of the screen in third. Second place was Logan Collins, who's really happy to be in this Coliseum setting. This is another event where he's doing well.
I'm just watching Matt Frazier chew up his first set of 10 pistols. He's grabbing the toe. Now, what that does, two things. It gives your hip flexors a break. Watch him grab the toe, keep the heel off the ground. Because what's happening is that what the GHDs is tax that middle portion of the body, the core and the hip flexors. The hip flexors allow you to keep the leg out straight. Grab the toe, don't work as hard. It also helps with your balance. Last thing, you don't want that heel to tap the ground when you have it in front, because that's also a no rep. Matt Frazier broke a lot on the GHD. Logan Collins had got off ahead of him, and you can see he's wearing those lifters. That just makes it a little bit easier to get down in the bottom of that squat on one leg.
Collins tied with Street Horner for the lead as they pass rep number 40, working to rep 240 total, which is when they will move to the Concept 2 rower for 40 calories. Joona Koski staying in contention, two reps behind the battle for the lead. Cody Anderson back to fourth. This is a movement that will go well for him. And Matt Frazier, for the first time in a long time in this event, perhaps since the start of it, is in the top five, sitting in fifth.
What's good for Matt Frazier relative to the guys that are ahead of him is that he's one of the stronger athletes in the field, and he's very good with a dumbbell. Collins needs to make or put some distance between him, Matt, and Joona Koski, because that dumbbell is going to be harder for him. I'm not saying it's going to be his downfall, but it will be harder for him than the other two athletes.
I feel like you can cue the iconic Jaws music right now. Matt Frazier, third out of the one-legged squats onto the rower. The rest of the way bodes very well for the defending champion.
See, Matt Frazier peeking to the right a little bit. He's trying to see where Koski is. What he was looking for was not the guy next to him, as Noah Olsen gets on the rower in the upper left part of your screen. He's looking at the clock. Now, he doesn't have to wave a cameraman out of the way like he had to do last night in Amanda, but he knows what the best time to beat is. He knows how long it took to get there. 12 minutes is the time to beat. He has less than 4 minutes to get through this end of this row and those 20 dumbbells push presses at the end.
And you look at the top four here in this heat, Joona Koski, Cody Anderson, Matt Frazier, and Scott Panchik moving into the picture. As the dumbbell should bode well.
Well, guys, that 100-pound dumbbell is very heavy, especially at the end of what's going to be 300 total reps. Something to keep in mind, a rule from the head judge, Adrian Bosman: they must control the dumbbell till it's below their waist. Why? It's not necessarily to add another half second of pain to these athletes. It's because these guys are very tightly grouped, and essentially, we don't want to go bowling for CrossFitters here.
Thank you, Sam. And one thing I do get curious about is Matt Frazier sitting in the seventh position. Remember back in 2015, the rower was one of the last elements in the entire competition. He said that he went out way too hot on the rower, along with the assault bike in that event.
I believe he said he went full dummy.
Full dummy was the
word. On the rower and assault bike. And now he said, don't go full dummy on the rower. But heck, it's okay if you're good at it. Matt Frazier ahead of the rest of the field. Now, this is one guy. If he gets his hands on the dumbbell ahead of you, it's going to be a hard fight to get back ahead of him.
Yeah, no offense to Logan Collins and Joona Koski, but you might be in trouble despite being tied for the lead, because Matt Frazier is going to move that dumbbell with ease. 100-pound dumbbell, 20 reps, shoulder to overhead. They'll advance it every 5 reps. They'll also alternate arms every 5 reps.
Well, Matt's going to have to do 21 because he got no rep on his third rep. And I said the hardest part about this rep is not getting it up. but it's re-racking to the shoulder with that single arm. Now, I think you can brace it with the opposite hand, and I'm surprised more athletes aren't using that to help stabilize in the bottom.
12 minutes, 0.26 seconds, the time to beat, and we're a minute 40 away from there. Matt Fraser trying to hold off Yonakowski, who's one lane over. Logan Collins is in the mix, but he's falling behind just a bit. And Matt Fraser with four reps remaining, working towards rep number 300. A year ago, seven second place finishes, one event win. Matt Fraser will get yet another event win this time, and 100 more points to increase his dominant lead here in the games through six events. Second place, Yonakowski and Logan Collins. Collins two reps behind Koski. Koski in the black tank top, yellow shorts. He will advance the dumbbell up onto the platform. Second place in the heat, second place in the event. Patrick Vellner has moved into this as well. He'll pass Logan Collins. Patrick Vellner onto the platform for a third place finish. Collins now having to hold off Scott Panchik. They're on opposite ends of the floor. Scott Panchik will finish ahead off camera in the fourth place position. And Logan Collins will have a foot race. Ooh, that's close.
Gerard, that guy.
Ricky Gerard always finds a way to make an event exciting. He legs out Logan Collins for fifth. Ben Smith just got no rep. It'll cost him a couple of seconds, but it won't cost him a position in the heat or the event. He will be in seventh. Four athletes working on the final five reps. The leader in that one is Noah Olsen with one rep remaining. He'll bring the dumbbell to the platform for an eighth place finish in the heat. The top eight in this heat will be the top eight in the event, as Travis Williams' time for heat number one will just now pass. Cody Anderson, the early leader, trying to hold off a few other athletes, including Alex Anderson, one lane over from him. And Anderson will get by the other Anderson and give it to Alex in that battle of namesakes. Dakota Rager tried to sneak in there as well. He'll be just behind them. And one of the favorites when it comes to chipper events got caught in this one, and Brent Fikowski is in a three-way race for the last place position here in this heat.
I was surprised to see what the pull-ups ended up doing to him in the very beginning. He was down in nearly singles and doubles in the last 10 reps to start this event. So this is a very surprising position for Brent Fikowski, who is sitting in second overall.
Speaking of points, Bjorgvin Carl Gudmundsson, 15th in the heat, 22nd in the event, and Matt Fraser is sitting very pretty right now. Yonakowski was fourth in the point standing, 76 points back. He takes second in the event, but everybody else around him is taking a gigantic hit, with the exception of Ricky Gerard.
You know, and I'm not saying I keep forgetting about Ricky, but that guy is making a very quick name for himself here at the CrossFit Games.
Brent Fikowski, 19th in the heat, 31st in the event. And there's one athlete left on the floor. And what a difference a couple of hours makes, because Garrett Fisher won the snatch competition with a 305-pound lift in event number five. In event number six, he's in danger of finishing last place.
But he knew he was down on the leaderboard, and he said he took some chances on the one rep max snatch. It's a little bit easier to, you know, make big jumps with such a singular focused event. This is a tough one for him. You know, longer events, high rep volume like this isn't necessarily in his wheelhouse. He's still a fantastic athlete with events like this. But when you come to the CrossFit Games, you know, I think some of these athletes are very surprised about how they felt after the first two events yesterday. I think that run, swim, run, and bike event made them much more fatigued than they were prepared for going into last night and today.
And let's face it, if you add those first two events up, you basically just did a sprint triathlon with a little bit of alteration of distances, but that's a lot of workload in that first day.
Well, it's a lot of workload and a lot of intensity. Because it's not your typical sprint triathlon where, let me get through the swim, I'll have a decent bike, and I'll, you know, run my 5K to the finish. Those guys went all out for about an hour straight. That will take its toll towards the end of the day.
Lone athlete to get hit by the time cap will be Garrett Fisher, not just in the heat, but in the event as well. He will take a last place finish. first place in the heat, his first place in the event. Fourth consecutive year that Matt Fraser racks up a win. He's gotten one win every single year of his career. This might be the one win he gets in 2017 if he follows that trend.
Like I said, he's really only worried about one win, and that's the win that puts him on top of the podium. Fraser Fikowski side by side at the beginning, but it was Koski that took the lead on the GHDs early on off the pull-up bar. But once they got through it, Fraser moved up ahead as he tried to run down about five or six athletes coming off the GHD, and he had that nice toe grab, making sure the heel stays off the ground, not working too hard. And there's the always aware Matt Fraser trying to look at Koski's screen. What's your pace? I'll stay just ahead of that. He'll peek to the right side, look at the clock. And the only thing he was looking for here at the end was the finish line. As he said, he's gonna get his first win here at the 2017 CrossFit Games, walking into his last five single arm snatches, opting for pretty much just a push press with it. And you see other athletes having to drop down. So Matt Fraser, I'm not saying he needed the win, but it's nice to have in your back pocket going in to the rest of the weekend.
He didn't necessarily need 100 points, but he's going to get them and increase his points lead after six events. As Matt Fraser takes this one by nearly 20 seconds over Yona Koski, Patrick Vellner, Scott Panchik, and Ricky Garrard round out the top five. And Matt Fraser is downstairs with Sam Farber.
Matt, your first win here in an event at the CrossFit Games here in Madison, Wisconsin. Earlier today, you performed so well in the home run derby of CrossFit, that one rep max snatch, and now here in the skills competition, you blow everyone away. What is the key to being so well-rounded in all these different types of events?
Just every day, I'm never working on stuff that I'm good at. It's always training my weaknesses. So, this is my first win. I don't have many peaks, but, it's pretty consistent across.
As a younger athlete, read about how you had a dream of being an Olympian and you had to give that up due to a back injury, but here you are in an arena that sits 10,000 people, they're all screaming for you. What does this experience compare? How does this experience compare to what you thought the Olympics might have been like as a weightlifter?
Olympic weightlifting crowd never roars quite like that, so I'm pretty content here.
Still have a lot more work to do, but just like last year, you're starting to pull away. How does this year's performance compare to what you did last year?
From last year, I tried to work on a bunch of my weaknesses, get out of some deficits, but same as last year, going into Saturday, we're not even halfway through the weekend yet. It's still a lot of competing to do, so I'll keep grinding.
Matt, thanks so much.
Thank you.
It's not often you see Matt Fraser smile in the middle of the competition, but he's got plenty of reason to. After six events, he has an 82-point lead over Yona Koski, who is the only athlete within 100 points of Matt Fraser after just six events. Ricky Garrard continuing the star-making season for him, sitting in third. Bjorgvin Carl Gudmundsson in fourth. Brent Fikowski goes from second to fifth here in this event.
Here's what I like to see. Look at all the different countries represented there in the top 10. This is where the sport is going. And I love to see this, especially on the men's side. We've seen it a lot on the women's side. But just look at the representation from the world.
Six different countries represented in the top 10. But once again, it's Matt Fraser out in front in commanding fashion after six events. Speaking of six events, we'll have event number six on the women's side coming up next.
we'll start with this.
Welcome back to Madison, Wisconsin, as it's time for women's event number 6, heat number 1 at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, and Amanda Krenz with you here at the Alliant Energy Center. It's the same setup. The only thing that changes the weight of the dumbbell here in the women's side of this event.
Yeah, we're kicking things off with 100 pull-ups right off the bat into those 80 GHC sit-ups. Pistols calorie row is to 40. And then that 70-pound dumbbell awaiting them, 20 reps, shoulder overhead, 5 on one side and the other, alternating until you get to the finish line. And one of the athletes I wanted to see happens to be her 39th birthday today. When you think about chippers like this, the one that I feel like always gets looked over is someone like Val Vogrel. And it's just a weird thing that she does, is just kind of fly under the radar. She'll never lead until kind of the very end. Well, she'll be up there, hopefully in the top 3 or 5 coming to the finish line. So I'll try not to let Val Vogrel sneak up on us here towards the end.
She does have a habit of doing that over the years, and right now she's sitting in the 4th position. It's Alethea Boone out in front, her name highlighted in blue, at rep number 62 of 100 pull-ups. Everybody else in the race will be highlighted in red, with the rep count showing how many reps they are behind. And that ticker at the top of the screen gets quite a workout during the opening portion of 100 pull-ups. It's now Brooke Wells out in front.
I'd like to see that from Brooke. You know, she's had a very rough start. And I say start, we're 6 events in at this point. And she was one of those athletes, I think, everybody was waiting to see how the offseason treated her, right? She dialed in her nutrition. She worked on her weaknesses. And she got better. She just hasn't been able to put it all together just yet here on the big stage. I want to see Brooke have a good bounce back event, just like I wanted Josh Bridges to in the previous men's event.
Lead has changed quite a bit between Wells, Jessica Coughlin, and Alethea Boone as they enter their final 10 reps on the pull-ups. And Alethea Boone, she had 0 points after the first 2 events, 39th and 40th in the points in each event. Since then, she's moved all the way up to 21st.
And it's just a product of events that she couldn't do, just with her, what happened to her last year with the torn Achilles. You know, you can't run for a very long time after that. You definitely can't get on a bike. You can swim, but what she can do is what she does best, gymnastics. That is Alethea Boone's game. And she said herself, she's like, I just kind of wanted to get back on the floor where I'm feeling the most comfortable. Well, she is on the floor. And she's had some great finishes since those first 2 yesterday.
So Alethea Boone out in front. Carolann Reason-Tebow is in second, 1 lane over from her. You see her in the blue shorts. Stacy Tovar in the yellow and purple combination in third. And for Carolann Reason-Tebow, you said about Brooke Wells, you're just kind of waiting for her to get in gear and start going. Reason-Tebow is another one of those athletes.
Well, she had a fantastic East Regional. And so that hasn't carried over either. And she was one of those, is like, maybe she's turned the corner a little bit. And sometimes it just happens to be a bigger stage than they're comfortable with. We know of a lot of athletes that thrive at the regional level. This is a completely different beast here at the CrossFit Games.
More than half of the field has moved on from the pull-ups, and in fact, right as I say that, another 4 athletes make their way onto the GHD sit-up. They're working toward rep number 180 with this chunk of 80 GHD sit-ups.
And that is a big chunk of GHD sit-ups. And what this is going to do is it's going to tax their core. It's not necessarily I would say, abdominal exercise, even though you use them to stabilize yourself throughout the movements, but it's that hip flexor. If you just kind of pat your hands right at the waistline of your shorts, those are the muscles that are really getting used here with this specific movement. Why is that important? Because the next movement you have waiting for you is that single leg pistol. In order to do that, you have to have strong core, a stable core, and very strong hip flexors, which are being blown up for 80 total reps.
Now, with this movement, one thing I'm noticing is about half of the athletes have their hamstrings, their glutes, on the pad. The other half of athletes, their glutes are hanging off of the pad. They're going past it. Right. Their legs are a little bit more extended. What's the difference there in what they're trying to accomplish?
Well, what they're doing is they're trying to kind of get around using their hip flexors. If you put your butt on top of the pad, now it becomes a core exercise because you're locking your hips into position. If you have it off the back, like you see Coughlin does, if they're off the back, that's when you get to use your legs and your hip flexors because it frees up the hip. If you slide up further, it becomes straight abdominal exercise, maybe like a ab mat sit-up on steroids, so to speak. That, in turn, if it doesn't hurt your back when you do it, because it would kill mine, is that it's saving their hip flexors for the pistols.
First off the pull-up bars, the first off the GHD, Alethea Boone out in front. She's going to have to back up a little bit. There's that little procedural element of this. They will advance every 10 reps. They'll alternate legs every rep. But if you do get a no rep on the right leg, you do have to complete a rep on that right leg before you can alternate.
I was about to panic again because I thought that was a clean rep by Alethea Boone. Wasn't really sure what they were looking for. She was just in the wrong space. You got to make sure you advance every 10. You see those 4x6 squares? That's where the work has to be done for the reps to count.
The numbers on the floor indicate what rep they are working towards. Right now, Alethea Boone working towards rep number 20, does get a no rep, and she will get the rep completed on that leg.
Oh, hey, Valerie Vobrel, there you are, just flying under the radar now in third place.
This time, unlike past years, we actually have our sights on her as she's making her way through the field in an event. So Alethea Boone in first, Carol Ann Reason-Tebow in the blue shorts in second, Valerie Vobrel in third, and in lane number one, all the way at the top of the screen a moment ago, is Casey Campbell in fourth. Alethea Boone on the left. You can see half of Carol Ann Reason-Tebow. There she is on the right side of that split on the left side, and Valerie Vobrel in third, now falling down to about fourth or fifth in the right side.
Well, it's coming from the tempo of the repetitions. Look at Boone on the left. It's one, another rep. Look at Val Vobrel on the right. She's in the middle part of your screen in the purple shirt. The tempo of her pistols are so much slower than the really the rest of the field. So where she caught up on the GHD, she's gonna lose a lot of time on these pistols if she can't pick up the pace relative to the field around her.
That leader's box on top of the screen shows rep 230 for Alethea Boone, working towards 240 in this portion of the chipper. This is the last of the gymnastics movements in this one. Next up, it'll be the Concept 2 rower for 40 calories, then 20 dumbbell shoulder to overheads with a 70-pound dumbbell. Keep an eye on the right side of the screen with Brooke Wells, who's making her move through the field.
Definitely, Brooke has one of the more unique styles when it comes to pistols. Traditionally, you'll see athletes kick that leg out in front. She kicks it out to the side. And it's not really an advantage or disadvantage. It's just a different type of technique than we usually see.
Alethea Boone onto the Concept 2 rower to start the 40-calorie row, a 16.4 interval lead over Carol Ann Reason-Tebow in second. And Brooke Wells is closing in. That's an awkward style on the pistols, as you were talking about, but it is definitely effective for the young athlete out of Missouri. But it's Alethea Boone trying to hold off both Wells and Carol Ann Reason-Tebow.
So she's about 40 seconds behind Boone when Boone got onto the rower. Splitting the difference between the two is Carol Ann Reason-Tebow in between. I could probably see Caroline get off the rower closer to Alethea, and I wouldn't be surprised to see Brooke Wells move up ahead. What I don't want to see is either one of these athletes work too hard to make up time. I'm not entirely sure how Boone's going to handle that dumbbell. If she can stabilize at the bottom, she'll be fine because she's a very explosive and powerful athlete. She also has good technique. Reason-Tebow and Wells has the strength on their side, especially Brooke Wells. If she can get within 20 to 30 seconds, she might be able to close the gap towards the end.
Now, we are having a scoring issue there. Carol Ann Reason-Tebow is not dropping out of the top five. I just believe we're not getting the rep count on the calorie counter, so I have to wait until she steps off the rower to know where she is in this lead battle. But Alethea Boone and Brooke Wells continuing to battle for the lead, and that is a battle now being won by Brooke Wells. It feels similar to what we saw a heat ago with Matt Fraser against a couple of other athletes like Logan Collins, where you just had that feeling the rest of the way bodes really well for one athlete. And in this case, it bodes well for Wells.
Well, she's a strong athlete. She's a power athlete. Those are good qualities to have when you get onto the rower, especially for Cals. Alethea and Carol Ann are not going to be as strong on the rope, but they don't need to be. What they need to make sure is they don't blow themselves up too fast. That dumbbell is going to get very heavy towards the end.
The race continuing towards 280 reps, which is 40 calories on the Concept 2 rower. We are having some scoring issues there, so we apologize about that. We'll work to clarify it, but simple enough. The first person to step off the rower has 20 reps remaining with the shoulder to overhead with a 70-pound dumbbell, and the judges' hands are up for both Alethea Boone and Brooke Wells, but Carol Ann Reason-Tebow will be the first one off the rower, and the former boxer might be finding her way punching that dumbbell up overhead 20 times and taking the heat win.
As she's getting it up at 70 pounds, that's a very heavy dumbbell for one arm, and it's something about isolating one side that makes it very challenging. Tebow has the 5-rep lead on Brooke Wells as she moves to her dumbbell, but Brooke Wells is also a very strong, powerful athlete if she can stabilize that dumbbell. That's going to be the hardest part, the re-rack of the dumbbell, especially on your weak side. It's just so awkward, it's so heavy. You're sweaty, you're tired. Use that other hand to stabilize at the bottom. You don't need to cycle these reps very fast. You just can't miss one.
They will advance the dumbbell every 5 reps. They'll also switch arms every 5 reps. Carol Ann Reason-Tebow is starting to struggle, working towards rep number 10. Brooke Wells takes a couple of steps forward. She has to go back into that box. That was a no rep because she left it. Carol Ann Reason-Tebow is past the halfway point. Wells, having to set the dumbbell down, opens the window for Alethea Boone. It's also Margo Alvarez starting to show up in this lead battle in fourth, and that bright yellow tank top and blue shorts. Carol Ann Reason-Tebow with 5 reps remaining. Alvarez moves into third ahead of Wells, right behind Alethea Boone. Alvarez with a quick transition. She might find herself in second place as Wells is starting to fade. Carol Ann Reason-Tebow cannot control the dumbbell overhead with 5 reps remaining.
Brooke Wells getting another no rep on the right side of your screen.
Alethea Boone with a quick transition. She has 2 reps remaining in the green pants on the left side of that left split screen. 1 rep remains, and the magic is back at the Coliseum for Alethea Boone. Events in the Coliseum. She PRs her snatch earlier today. She wins her heat in impressive fashion, a top 5 in the event last night, Amanda 45, and here she is, the heat winner again in event number 6. Carol Ann Reason-Tebow in second. Brooke Wells will take third. So the top 3, once we got to the one-legged squats, hold steady all the way through to the end of this one.
So impressed by the way Boone closed there at the end. Like I said, I thought she had the technique and strength to get through this. I just wasn't sure about the weight after all those repetitions. But where 2 other athletes fell apart, Boone put it all together.
Margo Alvarez in fourth. Race for fifth. We'll go to Madeline Sturt. She'll round out the top 5 here in heat number 1, the youngest athlete in the field for the 2nd straight year. Whitney Yellen will be their 6th place finisher. Carly Fuhrer trying to hold off Mackenzie Riley and Casey Campbell for 7th. Riley moving into that position. So we have 5 athletes working on the final 5 reps. And Mackenzie Riley will take the 7th position. Casey Campbell will take 8th in blue and yellow on the top of the screen. Carly Fuhrer with 1 rep remaining in blue and white. There she goes to the platform, just ahead of Jessica Coughlin in 10th. Stacy Tovar makes her way to the platform, 11th place finish. Alexis Johnson in 12th. A lot of finishers in a short time span here, from 13:52, Mackenzie Riley in 7th, 14:13, Alexis Johnson in 12th. Val Voberl, she was starting to make that move that she's known for, but once she got to the dumbbell, it all changed.
Well, I think she's doing fine with the dumbbell. It was really the pistols that were undoing. It was that pace. It was just much too slow for that high volume of reps. She was losing 1 to 2 seconds per leg towards the rest of the field.
Couple of Masters athletes finishing back-to-back. Kirsten Pedry in 14th, Val Voberl in 15th. Final few seconds, trying to get every rep possible. Jessica Griffith, she got every rep completed. She just did not reach the platform, so it will be a one-second time cap penalty. And Lauren Fisher will bring up the rear of the field here in heat number one. But once again on the Coliseum floor, a heat win for Alethea Boone, who may have more momentum than anybody not named Tia Toomey in the women's competition in the past few events, with one heat remaining coming up next. Welcome to the Electric Alliant Energy Center here in Madison, Wisconsin. One heat remains in event number six for the ladies, and it is the Triple G Chipper. Brandon Domain, Chase Ingram, and Amanda Krenz with you here in Madison. And after five events, Tia Claire Toomey is starting to pull away for the first time in this competition, 32 points ahead of Tennille Reed-Berline, Sarah Sigmund's daughter in third, Jamie Green and Annie Thoris' daughter round out the top five with this next test coming up.
And we have our Triple G Chipper, event number six of the weekend, starting with 100 pull-ups into the 80 GHD sit-ups, 60 alternating pistols, and then that 40 cal row. Where we've seen a lot of things shift is those last 20 dumbbell push presses with that 70-pound dumbbell.
It has been the game changer, 70 pounds, about 32 kilos for our global viewers, as we have a international flair here in the second heat of 20 athletes. And what has been a good points race all weekend long to this point, as we're nearing that halfway point here in day number two. As the ladies getting everything set up, adjusting the rower, their foot positioning on there, adjusting the GHD apparatus to make sure it's set for what they're looking for. And as they're looking for the right setting, what are you looking for here in this event?
Well, I'm looking at a couple athletes. You know, we talked about Tia Claire Toomey starting to pull away. We've seen her do that before and get reeled in. So she needs to really keep her focus and her confidence, which has really been the undoing for Tia Claire in the past 2 years at the CrossFit Games. First year, no expectations. Second year, very high expectations and some distractions. If you call the Olympic Games a distraction, I think it's a pretty good accomplishment. Tennille Reed, I love watching her compete. She's a true athlete out there. And then Jamie Green is living up to the hype.
And away we go. Heat number two of two in the Triple G Chipper. It starts with 100 pull-ups. Again, the time to beat, 12 minutes, 31.09 seconds by Alethea Boone. One heat to go. Leader's name will be highlighted in blue. Everybody else will be in red. And if it has a minus number next to their name, that indicates how many reps they are behind the lead.
I saw Katrin Davis' daughter, and she's behind the lead of a few people between her and Tia Claire Toomey, and possibly her third consecutive CrossFit Games Championship. These are the type of events that are good for her because of the athlete that she is and the coach that she has. I know her and Ben Bergeron, with the advanced notice of what this event was going to be about a couple weeks ago, it's the perfect opportunity for her to take advantage of that skill set.
Jamie Green out in front. She's through 55 for the 100 pull-ups. Doing so in about a minute. Fastest time we saw was Alethea Boone, who nearly went wire to wire on this one, leading the entire way. She came off the pull-up bar at 2 minutes, 21.4 seconds.
I'll still say it. We've done it for the last three heats. Is this, you don't need to go for broke on the pull-up bar. Even if you could do, say, 100 pull-ups unbroken and not phase you. It's not the only thing you're doing. This is the beginning of this race. You're going to get a break on the GHD coming up, but still, just give yourself a break, not just for your grip and your arms, that cardiovascular hit, the heart rate, just the core body temperature. You're about to flip upside down for 80 repetitions. Make sure you feel good going into the GHD.
15 reps remaining for the leader, Jamie Green. Annie Thorstadter saw her a moment ago in the blue sports bra, numbered 11. She is in the second position, 8 reps back. Kara Webb in third on this one. This isn't necessarily the movement that you would expect her to be battling for the lead with.
Yeah, but she's a phenomenal athlete, and I know she's one of the stronger ones in the field, but these are things that she's good at, dismantling longer workouts with high volume repetitions.
But it's Jamie Green out in front. First one through the pull-ups at 2 minutes, 9.6 seconds, about 15 seconds quicker than the pace of Alethea Boone in the last heat. Annie Thorstadter in blue and black makes her way to the GHD sit-ups, and Kara Webb will be right behind them as she finishes out her set of 100 pull-ups.
Still got a long way to go, but as we move from the pull-ups to the GHD, look at the pace these two athletes are going at. This is faster than any guy we saw in the men's event. I still think, you know, don't get too over your skis too soon. 80 repetitions is a lot. It's going to take almost 3 minutes to get through all 80 reps. Make sure you keep a nice, steady pace. Don't blow yourself up too early. The problem with GHD sit-ups is going upside down. That will mess with your heart rate and your just headspace. You don't want to get to the pistols dizzy and out of breath.
Here's a look at Tia Toomey, our points leader, 32 points clear of Tennille Reed-Burline in second. And for Tia Toomey, she was the 7th athlete off the pull-ups. How do you feel about her pacing there early on, getting to the GHD?
I think it's fine. Like I said, I think a couple of these athletes are going a little fast right off the start. But, you know, like I said before, it's hard to tell who's doing what correctly because we've had so much time after the release of this event, which means all these athletes should have practiced this event multiple times. They should know what rep scheme they want to have within perspective of things can go wrong, no reps can happen, you can feel good, you can feel bad. This is event 6. Knowing how much rest you want to take in between. So whoever comes off the pull-up bar first, or maybe even the GHDs, I'm not too worried about pace-wise because hopefully they've set their own tone. Now once we get to the pistols in the row, that's when I'll start to see if someone had made a good idea or a bad idea based off their pace in the beginning part of this event.
Jamie Green continuing to lead with 20 reps on the GHD sit-ups remaining, but it's only by a rep over Annie Thorstadter. Kara Webb hanging close, 5 reps behind that lead, as those three are starting to distance themselves from the rest of the field here in the second of 5 movements. Green on the bottom of the screen and the yellow shorts. Thorstadter in blue and black. One lane above her is Kara Webb in the blue t-shirt.
I like how close Kara is keeping to your top two leaders. Kara sitting in lane number 7, as she's only about 3 or 5 reps behind Annie Thorstadter, who's leading, and Jamie Green in between her. Kara's gonna do well on the pistols. This girl is strong, and she can move herself well in space.
New leader moving through the second and into the third movement onto the one-legged squats. Annie Thorstadter out in front, but only a couple of seconds ahead of Jamie Green and Kara Webb. And we've got a 3-rep differential first to third as they work through these one-legged squats.
Jamie Green on the right side of your screen. Look at that side-to-side rocking pace. Annie Thorstadter started with kind of that shuffle step. And what that is you'll see a squat kind of shuffle to one side where they kind of go 1, 2, 3. I do the same thing. I cannot go up and down like Jamie Green is in the 4 part of your screen. Annie Thorstadter is taking a little bit more time in between reps. Not necessarily a bad thing because that's her own pace. But Kara Webb and Jamie Green are doing pistols like their air squats. And when you lose a half a second, maybe every 1 or 2 reps, you've now fallen 30 seconds behind at the end of 60.
Webb in first, Green in second, Thorstadter in third, separated by 5 reps of each other. Webb on the far left, Thorstadter in blue and black in the middle. And on that right split screen is Jamie Green in second now. Kristen Holta and Kerry Pierce are 20 reps behind these top 3 athletes. So the top 3 really starting to separate themselves.
Now, Annie isn't falling far behind, just a little bit. Where Annie will make up ground, and this might be to her strategy, is when she gets onto the rower. She's taller of the 3. She's a very powerful, long athlete. That bodes well when you're rowing for cals, especially 40 cals on the women's side. That's a tough number. That's a high volume number for these athletes at that point in time in the event.
This could be huge, by the way, looking at the bigger picture. Jamie Green and Annie Thorisdottir battling for the lead in this event. Tia Toomey, Tennille Reed-Berline, and Sarah Sigmundsdottir are 9th, 10th, and 11th.
And you're talking about only being up 31 points. Those points drop drastically once you're outside the top three. So putting yourself 10, 15 people between you and the first place on the leaderboard, you can make up a lot of ground very quickly.
Similar to Ricky Garrard on the men's side, this has been a star-making games appearance and their debut appearance for Jamie Green.
I think the hardest thing about getting to the games as a rookie is getting to the games with expectation. And Jamie Green's expectation was that she won the Open in 2016. She went team, and their team got third place at the CrossFit Games last year. So your name has been in the news for an entire year with everyone wondering how you're going to fare as an individual. So not only are you a rookie on the stage as an individual, she has been here before on team. It is completely different beast once you get here. To manage expectation speaks volume to your mentality and your confidence coming in.
Jamie Green has lived up to the hype. She enters this event fourth in the point standings, 66 points behind Tia Toomey, the points leader entering event number 6. Green with a 10-calorie lead over Cara Webb and Annie Thorisdottir. Katrin Davidsdottir has moved herself into the fifth position in a battle with Kerry Pierce for fourth.
You can see on the right side of your screen, Briggs is just getting to the rower, so she was well behind the rest of the field after the GCs and Pistols, but she's moved up. This is where someone, I would say, this is where you want to actually make your move. Sam Briggs crushing on 40 cals isn't going to tax her like it would other athletes. Sam Briggs can take a chance here, especially after what happened in the snatch where she toppled about 5 places down to 8. Take a chance to catch up to the rest of the field on something that you're very, very good at.
Right as I was about to say that Jamie Green was starting to distance herself from Webb and Thorisdottir for the first time, Cara Webb broke for it on the rower, and she is the first one off the Concept 2 rower into that 70-pound dumbbell for 20 reps. Again, they'll advance it every 5. They'll also switch arms every 5 reps.
Cara Webb is push-pressing the 70-pound dumbbell, and I didn't want to speak too soon, just saying as if she gets it that in her hands, it's going to be very hard to chase her down. But look at Jamie Green on the right. She's driving, dipping underneath with the legs, and then standing up. Watch Cara Webb on the left. Dip, drive, press overhead. She's push-pressing the 70-pound dumbbell. To me, chasing that might break my spirits if I was Jamie Green.
She's been able to jerk a barbell that was 130 kilos, about 285 pounds. A 32-kilo, 70-pound dumbbell, that's nothing for Cara Webb. And she's through 10 of the 20 reps. Annie Thorisdottir in third, trying to chase down Jamie Green.
Now, Jamie Green, I was about to say that. She's looking to her right for Cara Webb. She needs to look back behind her shoulder a little bit more as Annie Thorisdottir moves in after her first set of 5, because Annie is going to be able to move that dumbbell very well herself.
For Cara Webb on the left side of the screen, 5 reps remaining. She is arguably the best female to have never podiumed at the CrossFit Games. There were the couple of years where she was in contention and injuries derailed her, or heat issues derailed her. Cara Webb is looking for her 4th career event win, along with her first trip to the podium. And Cara Webb, she won the snatch competition. She wins event number 6 as well.
Back-to-back wins for Cara Webb. 200 points. That is going to be huge for her status on the leaderboard. Jamie Green looks like she might be able to hold off Annie Thorisdottir. Annie might need to worry about Tennille Reed behind her.
And this is big for Jamie Green. 4th in the point standing, 66 points behind Toomey for first. And Green is going to pick up 94 points out of 100 here in this event.
Annie's starting to slow up just a little bit. I like her re-gripping with the opposite hand. She'll bring it down, stabilize, and then drive it back overhead.
One heat to go. We're playing that game of, is Valerie Vovorel going to pop up late in this one? Sarah Sigmund's daughter is doing her best Val Vovorel impersonation. She was 13th at one point in this event. She's now trying to pass Thorstadter for third. She won't be able to do that as Thorstadter takes third, but Sarah Sigmund's daughter out of nowhere moves into fourth place.
Well, another daughter creeping up at the same time is Katrin David's daughter over in lane number 12, who is on about eighth behind Toomey. This is an opportunity for David's daughter to close that gap a little bit after event number six.
Sigmund's daughter takes fourth. She was 60 points behind Toomey for the points lead. Carrie Pierce will be fifth, just ahead of Katrin David's daughter. Next finisher should be Tennille Reed Burline, as she makes her way across the line in blue and white in lane number 11. So the second place points athlete, 32 points behind Toomey, will also gain ground on the points leader. On the men's side, event six separated the field by a wide margin. On the women's side, event six is going to squeeze this points gap like a vise. And there is the points leader currently holding the ninth position, but she's one of five athletes on the final five reps. Ninth place in the heat for Toomey. And this one's gonna hurt, as it looks like she'll be 12th place in the event. Alessandra Pacelli. It's in a close one with Cassidy Lance McQuarter, and she will edge her out by 0.04 of a second. And Pacelli, we do want to clarify one thing. If you were with us on the broadcast at event number five, it looked like she won the event. She actually had a misloaded bar. The bar was lighter than it should have been. She winds up third in that one, and that is why Carl Webb took the win in event number five. Danny Horan, Sam Briggs with two reps remaining each, now one rep remaining. Horan in lane number one on the opposite end of the floor of Briggs. Horan set the dumbbell down, Briggs did not, and that will give her the edge on the position for 15th in the heat. And Sam Briggs is having a rough couple of events. She came into event number five tied for third, entered this event in eighth place, and she's gonna continue to drop down the standings. Three athletes remaining, China Cho on the right, Turi Helgadottir in the middle, and Emily Abbott on the near side of the screen. Final 45 seconds until the 15-minute time cap that only took out one athlete in heat number one, that being Lauren Fisher. China Cho, three reps remaining with a 70-pound dumbbell. Turi Helgadottir trying to not even set that dumbbell down on the transition with 30 seconds remaining. Every position matters, every point matters at the course of this four-day weekend. And China Cho will hold on to the 18th position in the heat, just ahead of Turi Helgadottir, who's struggling to get this final rep. She just has one rep and the sprint to the mat remaining. There's the rep. She's got 5 seconds to get to the platform, and she will beat the time cap. And Emily Abbott will be the lone athlete here in heat number two, unable to finish all the work before that 15-minute limit. And Carl Webb, 200 points out of a possible 200 in the last two events.
I like the way this leaderboard is starting to look after six events, because who we thought was pulling away just got reeled back in, and it started with Jamie Green on the pull-up. She had the fastest split of the day. Took her just over 2 minutes to get through, and then Annie Thorstadter made her move on the GHD sit-ups to put her in the first place position. And then once we got to the pistols, Annie was a little bit slower, and then you had Jamie Green and Cara Webb just ripping through these reps. Look at that. She can do pistols faster than I can do air squats. These two got on the rower first, and they kind of went back and forth for the 40 cals, where Jamie Green and Cara Webb never really relinquished that top position. But once Cara Webb got her hands on the dumbbell, someone needs to check what the weight was, because I'm not sure if that was 70 pounds. She made that look very, very easy.
And Kara, I'm going to ask you about this event in just a moment. First of all, though, you found out that you won the last event, too. Did that come as a surprise to you?
Yeah, it did, actually. I was kind of being a little bit strategic, and I said on camera before that when I didn't win a strength event at the Games, that I had done something right in my training, meaning that I've been doing all the stuff that I really suck at and needed to take a hit on that. And I was really happy that I didn't win it, and then I won it by accident, and I'm like, damn.
Well, I don't think you won this one by accident. I'm curious what your plan was coming into this chipper.
I had one plan, and that was to do me. And I had no plan of how many pull-ups I was going to do, anything I was going to do. I just tried to look straight down my lane and not really worry about what anyone else was doing and just stay really in tune with what my body had to offer and nurture that the best I could. And if I keep doing that, then, you know, I'm going to have really cool things happen, hopefully, for the rest of the weekend.
You're an experienced Games athlete, but you're in an entirely new venue. What has it been like competing with these girls again, but in the Coliseum in Madison, Wisconsin?
Madison's amazing. This is, yeah, right? This is a lot more like home for me, the humidity and kind of like the bit of the rain for training. So it's pretty fun and it's different, and it revamps the whole experience for a veteran like myself. You know, this is my sixth game, so it's really nice to to mix it up a little bit. Beautiful venue. The Coliseum is amazing. Like the atmosphere, the pure volume in here is epic. So, yeah, it's great.
Good luck the rest of the weekend.
Thank you.
It's a big W for the athlete they call Big Dub. Kara Webb taking her second consecutive event win for the first time all weekend. We have a repeat event winner for the first time in six events. Kara Webb at 10:45.72. Jamie Green in second. Annie Thor's daughter, Sarah Sigmund's daughter, and Carrie Pierce round out the top five. And as I mentioned a little bit ago, after six events, the women's field has just been squeezed together like a vice in the point standings. There's a lot of fitness on the floor because there's an announcement to come on what's left tonight. We'll have that in a bit. We'll also have what that announcement is being played out on the floor in just a little bit.
The Triple G Chipper is in the books, and congrats to Kara Webb for her second straight event win. Welcome back inside the Beer Garden, everyone. We're going to get you guys caught up to speed on everything competition related, but stick around, guys, because Director of the Games, Dave Castro, has a special announcement in the Coliseum for the individuals about their final event of the day.
This, my friends, has been a very, very long day. But obviously, it's not over. You guys started this morning with a little frolic through a playground. Then you guys got to throw some weight around. And finally, you tackled this nasty high rep, actually not high rep, medium rep chipper. Now, it's time to do something where you don't have to strategize, where you don't have to make a plan, where all you have to do is go out there and put in fucking work. And to do that, to express that work, we have something very special that brings this big smile to my face. Bill, have your crew bring it. You guys, open up. This, my friends, is 20 feet of pure,
keep rolling it,
beauty. Remember that? You guys know your game's history? Bring out the rest, Katie. Does anybody recognize this? Paul Tremblay, where are you? Demo team, get over here. Give him the hammer. On the buzzer, he will run forward and make that go from there to there. Stand by. Beep. Stop, 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 stop. This is CrossFit. This is CrossFit. Let's add a little piece to it. Let's add a little component. How about we do 20 feet of this and maybe 40 calories on an assault bike to start it off? I don't know. You guys like that? You guys want to do that? Bring out the assault bike. The final event for this evening is 40 calories on the assault bike. Move your object 20 feet with a sledgehammer. Four time, 40, 30. 40 calories for the men, 30 calories for the women. Are you guys excited? I sure the fuck am. That's it, let's go. Time to warm up.
Well, there you have it. Dave Castro just made an announcement that we're bringing back a piece of equipment that we saw way, way, way back in 2012. If you guys don't remember, it's called the Banger. Way back then, we did three versions of it. Today, we're just using the low banger, 40 calories on the salt bike, 30 for the women, and then the low banger. They're going to take this on in just a moment. Dan, with this particular workout, it's going to be fast. This is a very different time domain than we've seen than some of the other workouts so far.
Yeah, like Dave mentioned, it couldn't be much simpler. There's not a lot to think about here. It's all gas pedal. So you're going to see most of these guys and most of the women throttle down on that assault bike, try to get off of it as quick as they can, and then jump on that hammer. It's something they're not used to. I can guarantee you not many people have been practicing this. It's probably something that got ignored since 2012. Mm-hmm. It's just kind of, that's a one-off thing, and we're not going to pay attention to it. Well, now it's coming back to haunt you. Mind you, they just did 100 pull-ups, a whole lot of rowing, throwing that dumbbell overhead. That's going to be a factor when coming into this workout.
Yeah, these athletes are pretty exhausted at this point, but you're a renaissance man. You've got some experience in this field. You're one of the few athletes that have taken on this banger way back in 2012. Talk to me about what it's like to actually use this implement. That face, oh, that looks a little familiar. Is that you? I don't know.
No, that one's Casper Bauer.
Man,
it's
close.
Looks
like you.
We're almost twins.
You guys look awfully similar.
Yeah.
But what's it like to actually hit this low banger, and what kind of tax toll does it take on the body?
For the athletes who haven't done it before, I can almost guarantee the first swing is going to be really frustrating because that plastic, I'm assuming it's the same hammer, is plastic. It's not as heavy as you might think, and it wants to bounce away from whatever you're swinging it at. So there's going to be some frustration. There's going to be some trying to figure out exactly how to move that across the way the best and fastest way that they can. I can tell you when I had to do it in 2012, I didn't know what to expect. We coupled it with double under so our arms are tired, and then swinging that hammer, I was super frustrated when I got to it. I couldn't get done what I wanted to do. The main thing the athletes can focus on, core to extremity movement. If you're just swinging from your arms, you're not going to get the force production you want out of the hammer. Start here at the core, finish off with the arms, plow that thing down the rail, and you'll be done the fastest.
Yeah, there's not going to be much time for people to be frustrated in this workout because of how fast it's going to be. But first, we're going to get you guys caught up on some of the action that went down on the team competition. They are done for the day. Teams just took to the floor a little while ago for event number 7, the Roe and the Worm. And it was Wasatch and Mayhem battling it out for the top spot. And Wasatch CrossFit looked very strong throughout.
Right, Tommy. Wasatch took first in that workout and their first overall right now. Mayhem finished third in that workout. That actually moved them back up a couple spots as Invictus and some other teams struggled. Invictus was actually capped in that workout, it appears. So they have some work to, and Mayhem actually has some work to do still with 2 days left.
And then we did see Mayhem here as they were going to the finish, drop the Worm, and it crossed that red line. Remember, the Worm has to stay within the box. They actually got called back. Some uncharacteristic mistakes from the crew from CrossFit Mayhem.
Yeah, you don't see that from Mayhem typically at all. They're very familiar with the Worm. I've trained with them with the Worm before down there. They know what to do with it.
Yeah, but still managed to get third place in that workout. And here are the results from event number 7, Wasatch CrossFit 1023. Timberwolf CrossFit, a strong finish, their second straight second place finish in that event. CrossFit Mayhem in third, Milford OC3, a couple other teams rounding out the top 5. And here are your overall results. After day number 2 and through 7 events, Wasatch CrossFit jumps into the lead with 510 points. Mayhem still within striking distance, 24 points back. Milford's had a strong day as well, moving up into the top 3. Timberwolf CrossFit behind that second place finish moves up into 6th. And then Fort Vancouver, Back Bay, a couple of teams we saw after day 1 still holding on strong. And now we just saw the men finish up the chipper a little while ago, and it certainly was another strong performance from none other than Matt Fraser.
I mean, he's putting so much distance between him and the field right now, it's scary. Guys are going to have a lot of work to do. They're going to have a lot of work to catch up to this guy. Both him and Koski crushed the workout, dominated the GHD sit-ups. I believe both of them were pretty much off at the same time, first and second. You can see him here, not really throttling down anywhere in the workout. It's just moving on methodically from one movement to the next, handled that 100-pound dumbbell with no problem, ran it across the finish line for another event win.
Yep. Matt Fraser, it just extends his lead. What can't he do at this point? You know, we've gone outside on the bicycle. We've run, we've swim. A classic CrossFit chipper here. You know he's going to do strong. The event win for Matt Fraser just extends his lead. And we saw a guy in Brent Fikowski who normally with chippers and with these strategic heavy events, he does really well, but this was not the case tonight.
Now, 31st in that workout, he took a hit there. Somewhere in there, he hit a wall. You can tell right now he's actually behind on the pull-ups for the whole field, trying to get onto those GHD sit-ups. Taking a break there, looks like he has to make an adjustment there on his GHD sit-ups. We don't know if that's something was bothering him. He didn't get it set up beforehand. Out there alone on the floor with the dumbbell, very uncharacteristic, like you said, for Fikowski.
Brent Fikowski was one of the top 3 athletes coming into the event. This finish outside of the top 10 would hurt him. He's clearly not happy, and for good reason. A 31st place finish in that workout drops him down the leaderboard a little bit. Matt Fraser wins the event. Janikowski in second. Another strong performance from Patrick Bellner as he starts to climb up. Scott Panchik, Ricky Garrard, two names that have been strong all weekend. Ben Smith, another top 10 finish. That'll improve his standing. And these are your overall results going into the final event of the night tonight for the men after 6 events. Matt Fraser continuing to extend an 82-point lead over second place Janikowski. Rookie Ricky Garrard holding strong in third. And look at all the different flags there in the top 10. It is great to see the international flair from all of these athletes.
Absolutely. That is a cool thing to see.
And Jason Smith, Republic of South Africa, one of the first South Africans to make it to the games in the top 10. So nice to see him up there as well. Most recently, we saw the women finish up the Triple G Chipper. And for the second event in a row, Kara Reb walks away with an event win.
That's going to be huge for her. Those 100-point victories, you can't put a price on those at the games. She moved through this incredibly well, was right with Annie there on the pistols. I believe Jamie Green was also pretty close to her when they were getting onto the rower. They were kind of neck and neck. Kara looks to be incredibly calm, putting in the calories, jumped off to that dumbbell and handled it 10 times better probably than any other woman in the field. It looked like it was really easy for her.
Yeah, Kara Reb basically push-pressing it and moving it as well as anyone we've seen thus far tonight, men or women. Second straight workout where she walks away with 100 points. You can't ask for anything better than that. Surely going to move her up into the standings. These are the results from the workout. Kara Reb, 10:45, another strong performance from the rookie Jamie Green. A pair of Icelandic women, Annie Thor's daughter and Sarah Sigmund's daughter, third and fourth. Kari Pierce a much needed performance in this event with a fifth, catching David's daughter right behind her. These are your overall results going into the assault banger tonight. Tia Claire Toomey still in the lead, but her lead is slightly shrinking over the likes of Tennille Reed, Jamie Green, and Sarah Sigmund's daughter, moving herself within 32 points. Carl Webb moves up into sixth after two event wins. And now we have the assault banger to look forward to, which should be an exciting event. You heard director of the games, Dave Castro, say that there's no strategy here, just work. So thinking about that workout, who do you have in mind to do well?
I'm picking the Clydesdales. I'm picking the big boys. We're talking Ricky Garrard, Patrick Vellner, Brent Fikowski, and Paulson. All right, these guys are going to be pushing enough wattage on that assault bike to basically power our campus. They can do it, too. I mean, they'll be off that 40 calories faster than most people in regular gyms could imagine. On the women's side, I'm going to go with Sarah Annie Briggs, who's a firefighter. She's got some familiar with that kind of implement. And then Tovar as well. Important to note, Annie and Tovar have both done this implement before in 2012 at the games when we saw some footage earlier.
Powering the powering the Alliant Energy Center, that's a great idea, hooking up those bikes. Maybe that's a plan for us in the future.
When you see them all going at one time with those guys, the fists are going to be flying. It's going to be impressive.
Looking forward to seeing some power output from these athletes in this event. Going to take a quick break, but don't go away. When we come right back, we're going to get you updated on the teenage and masters divisions.
I feel kids are definitely isolated. They're in their phone instead of in the present moment with their friends. I think it definitely distorts the social interactions. For me, coming from my past, from the way I was affected with, you know, being a young kid, being exposed to fitness, and the benefits that I saw with it, I definitely wanted to just come here and bring some of the Santa Cruz. When I see all ages performing in Olympic movements and looking good, looking sound, it makes me feel really good. And to see these kids create this like strong base where whatever they want to do as they grow, they want to play soccer, they want to go run track, it just gives them this strong foundation where now they're free to go with whatever they want to choose. I feel really good with the consistency of the kids. I feel really good with the steady growth. Because, you know, the longer a kid stays, the longer I actually get to know them, I get to connect with them. Always at the end, I'm so stoked that I do it. My name is Daniel Jay, and I'm a CrossFit Kids coach.
Hey guys, Ro here to remind you that just because the CrossFit Games season's winding down, it does not mean that we're gonna hang up our fitness until next year. This offseason will play host to all the competitions that you've come to expect as a fan and an athlete. Some big changes will kick things off with a team series in late September. All you need is one other person and $20 per person, and you can play along from your home gym. October will host the CrossFit Liftoff powered by Ro. Two Max Lifts and a Metcon all contain chances to win gear, cash, and of course, pride. Finally, in November, the War of the CrossFit Worlds pits the fittest athletes from the US, Canada, Australia, and Europe against one another in the Reebok CrossFit Games Invitational. Stay tuned to games.crossfit.com for all the information you need on how to watch and play along yourself.
Back, everyone, back inside the beer garden here at the Alliant Energy Center for the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. We're here at the Day at the Games desk. I'm joined by Dan Bailey and none other than everyone's favorite Australian commentator, Jeremy Austin, you legend, giving us an update on the teens and masters competition. We're going to start with the teenage competition. What was the big story coming out of day number two?
A lot of stuff went down today, especially on the obstacle course. The big surprise, however, is our youngster, Kayla Stefano. She's just come out of 14-15 as the champion. It's her first year in 16-17. She's on top.
Scary. She still has another year, right?
I know. Still another year there, and she's doing really well without winning an event so far. So very, very consistent.
What can you tell us about that 35 to 39 division? I'm pretty interested in it because, you know what? I'm pretty close to that age.
And know a few guys and competed against them as well.
Absolutely.
The big news out of there is that Neil Maddox, no surprise, it was two strength events, and he won both of them, and two wins, and he's sitting on top of the leaderboard.
Shocking.
A couple of points ahead of Kyle Kassabauer, but yeah, he's up the top now, which is cool.
Two good names there.
Yeah, exactly right.
Yeah,
and a little bit of a surprise here, moving up to the 40 to 44 division, a past champion struggling a little bit.
Yeah, Helen Harding, our champion from last year, she did come in with a knee injury into the event. However, it's not proving to be a really good event for her so far. Still 2 days of competition to go. She's sitting in eighth, but slowly clawing her way back. So we'll see what happens over the next couple of days. But hopefully the knee holds up.
And something I'm excited to see play out the next couple of days, the men's 45 to 49 division. This is pretty close at the top.
Really close. Our champion from last year, Ron Matthews, 15th in the first event. Now, yeah, pretty devastating for Ron. He's currently in second. So wow. A big jump up for him. The obstacle course was out of control. He's what, 240 pounds. He's 6'4", big unit, and blitzed the obstacle course. But between him and James Grundler, Brent Myers actually winning at the moment. Between Brent and James Grundler in fourth, 28 points. That one is going to be a really tight race to the end.
And then one last little update on the 50 to 55 division with Will Pallison. Actually, pretty cool stuff happening despite his placement so far.
It did, yeah. He didn't go to plan yesterday with a run, swim, run. But coming back, he hit the obstacle course, and he actually took out a first position, which is pretty awesome. And he's back into 15th, so looking good for Will Powell with 2 days of events to go.
I have to ask, you dropped a couple of awesome Australian catchphrases for us yesterday. You got anything new for us today?
Well, today at the obstacle course, it was an absolute rip snorter. It was so good. The 60-plus women were ripping it up. It was, absolute clanger.
I love it, Jeremy. We're going to have Jeremy back every day to try and give us an update on Teens and Masters. He's going to stick around, but we're going to take a quick break. When we come right back, we're going to get you guys updated on the team series as well as a few other stuff going on around the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games.
I feel kids are definitely isolated. They're in their phone instead of in the present moment with their friends. I think it definitely distorts the social interactions. For me, coming from my past, from the way I was affected with, being a young kid and being exposed to fitness and the benefits that I saw with it, I definitely wanted to just come here and bring some to Santa Cruz. When I see all ages performing in Olympic movements and looking good, looking sound, it makes me feel really good. And to see these kids create this like strong base where whatever they want to do as they grow, they want to play soccer, they want to go run track, it just gives them this strong foundation where now they're free to go with whatever they want to choose. I feel really good with the consistency of the kids. I feel really good with the steady growth. Because the longer a kid stays, the longer I actually get to know them. I get to connect with them. Always at the end, I'm so stoked that I do it. My name is Daniel Jay, and I'm a CrossFit Kids coach.
Hey guys, Ro here to remind you that just because the CrossFit Games season's winding down, it does not mean that we're gonna hang up our fitness until next year. This offseason will play host to all the competitions that you've come to expect as a fan and an athlete. Some big changes will kick things off with the team series in late September. All you need is one other person and $20 per person, and you can play along from your home gym. October will host the CrossFit Liftoff powered by Ro. 2 Max Lifts and a Metcon all contain chances to win gear, cash, and of course, pride. Finally, in November, the War of the CrossFit Worlds pits the fittest athletes from the US, Canada, Australia, and Europe against one another in the Reebok CrossFit Games Invitational. Stay tuned to games.crossfit.com for all the information you need on how to watch and play along yourself.
We are back here at Day at the Games, but you just heard the most handsome man in CrossFit, Roy McKernan, talking about the team series and some updates that we've got this year. It's going to be a pairs competition, male, female, or mixed. Anyone over 14 can't compete. Registration, you can go and do it now. You can register at games.crossfit.com. The competition will run for 2 consecutive weeks from September 20th to October 2nd. It's going to be a blast. Trust me on this. I've done it the last few years, and it's always a good time to get out there and compete. Remember, guys, if you want to be a part of the conversation all weekend long, be sure to hit us up on social media with your posts using the hashtag CrossFit and CrossFit Games. Remember, Brooke Entz issued a competition earlier for your best Madison handstand. You can use the hashtag Madison handstand on top of those two hashtags that we just mentioned. If you guys are at home, can't make it here, here's how you can keep up with everything regarding the CrossFit Games, watching all of the competition both on television and online. You can watch it on CBS, on CBS Sports Network. We'll have a two-hour nightly recap as well as a live hour window tomorrow on CBS. Then every heat, every competition, individual, team, masters, and teens is live coming to you guys for free. That's right, I said it, forfree.com, games.crossfit.com, or the Facebook page for the CrossFit Games. We're streaming everything for you guys, unprecedented. If you haven't already, guys, please go download the CrossFit Games app. If you're on site, it's going to be crucial. It's your roadmap to the CrossFit Games. You can organize your schedule based on your athletes, based on what events you want to watch, based on what division you want to watch, and it'll send you notifications as well. Just go to the App Store and search 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. That's going to do it for us here at the Day at the Games Studio. For Dan Bailey, I'm Tommy Marquez. Enjoy the final event of the night, individual event 8, the Assault Banger.